So I welcome all to the second day. Yesterday we had an incredible start to the session with the keynote address by Professor Vinay Kumar Srivastava sir, which was for the session by Professor Jesuratnam sir and Professor Chella Purmal sir. And they focused on evolutionism and neo evolutionism respectively, and today the session would focus on culture and identity. And it is an important one because as we individuals do have identities, personal identities, and we deal, and these identities deal with the belongingness to a certain community, to a certain group. So I would welcome both the professors who are delivering the talk on this essential topics, Professor Gregory and Professor N. Sudhakar Rao. I welcome you, sir, and I would like Balwan, sir, to please introduce them.
Thank you, Anidita. Thank you. It's my pleasure as a General Secretary Aspire. I welcome both the professors because both the professors are very close to me, and I would say they are very eminent in their profession. Whenever I approach them, they used to guide me and they used to help me a lot regarding development of anthropology and anthropologist. So now I welcome Professor Gregory to deliver a lecture on culture. Please take a charge, sir.
Hello, do you hear me?
Yeah, hello. Yeah, sir. Yeah, yeah. Yes, sir. I'm hearing you, sir.
Okay, sir. A very good afternoon to all. Aspire has been taking very many initiatives in the service of anthropology, which are very laudable. It needs to be appreciated in no uncertain terms. Also, I must thank the Aspire for the opportunity given to me to be part of this international webinar on anthropological theories. Yesterday, we heard a wonderful talk by Professor Vinay Kumar Srivastava while inaugurating this webinar, followed by the two illuminating lectures by Dr. Jesuratnam and Professor Chella Perumal on evolutionism and neo-evolutionism respectively. Today, we will deliberate on the early anthropological theories that had contributed to the understanding of the nature of culture and society. It is common knowledge that culture has come to be accepted as a key concept in the study of anthropology. However, the term culture is still elusive in its meaning, as it is understood differently by different people with different connotations. Going to the root of the word, the term colere in Latin means to cultivate. In a layman's view, a cultured person may be referred to a person of high learning, especially in art, music, and literature, who is also expected to be a well-mannered, well-bred, refined, and gentle person. It is used here as synonymous with the development or improvement by training and education. In some contexts, civilization has come to mean as an advanced form of culture, achieving excellence in the areas of art, music, literature, and other finer things of life. In anthropology, culture stands for much more than what have been implied in the above understandings. It is being said that the concept of culture has been developed out of the need for a convenient term to characterize the common aspects of certain kinds of behavior that, although not completely absent in other species, are highly developed in man. In other words, to be a human being is also to be a cultured being, irrespective of time, space, and development. If so, what is culture? One of the earliest definitions of culture had come from E.B. Tyler, who has come to be known as the father of modern anthropology. According to him, culture is that complex whole which includes knowledge, belief, art, morals, law, custom, and any other capabilities and habits acquired by man as a member of society. The present task before me is to dwell on the nature of culture as it had come to mean and understood in the early years of the development of the concept in anthropology, the post-Tylorian era, particularly in the first half of the 20th century, the context of America under the pioneering leadership of Franz Boas, who came to be known as the father of American anthropology. In fact, the history of anthropological thought is also seen as the history of the different perspectives of culture. To begin with, let us take an overview of the journey of anthropology in the understanding of culture through its different theoretical perspectives. The age-old attempt to explain the human conditions became a science in 1871 when E.B. Tyler set forth a definition of culture as a complex whole that is learned and passed on to the succeeding generation. Tyler tended to view culture as a universal effort to civilized condition and identified culture as civilization. The Victorian view of culture as an evolutionary progress during the pioneering years of the development of anthropology, of which E.B. Tyler was at the forefront in Britain and L.H. Morgan in America, the attempt was to reconstruct the history of humankind as a whole. With Morgan's identification of evolution as a series of stages from savagery to barbarism to civilization, which continued to dominate till the end of the 19th century. The dominating principle during this time was the psychic unity of humankind under the perspective of unilinear evolution. This view had a comeback in the mid-20th century in different forms, one such view having been that of Leslie White, who saw in human history a pattern in which the increased harnessing of energy for culture building, starting from human energy, subsequently and progressively enhanced by animal energy, followed by fuel energy, atomic energy, etc., onset of the 20th century till the mid-20th century, lasting nearly for 5 decades, saw the rejection of the sweeping generalizations about human history, taking human culture as a whole, by Franz Boas in America, who preferred to concentrate instead on what could be learned about the histories of specific cultures as integrated wholes. In Boas' view, each culture is uniquely shaped by historical processes such as diffusion and integration of traits, and hence should not be judged by standards developed in another culture. The understanding was that all cultural patterns are equally valid and need to be understood in their own terms, with no possibility of a single standard of comparison, similar to Tylor's Victorian standard. Here, culture as a single thread of development was replaced with more flexible and relativistic approach. The Boasian view of culture was taken forward and further refined by his own disciples, including Alfred Kroeber, Edward Sapir, Ruth Benedict, Margaret Mead, and others, who dominated the American anthropology till the mid-20th century. Benedict emphasized the seemingly unlimited diversity of cultural phenomena. Lies not only in the history of functioning institutions, but also in the temperament of the people, including the patterns of emotions and attitudes, what she called the personality configurations. Hence, Benedict insisted that to understand culture, one should be aware of the underlying patterns that holds everything together. Thus, the configurational approach to culture viewed society as generated by culture patterns, and from the pattern view of culture, culture was viewed as pattern personality. As was in America, Britain too, there was a radical shift taking place during the same period under the leading figures of British anthropology, Malinowski and Radcliffe Brown, from the unilinear evolutionary understanding of culture of the entire humanity to the particular, but with a differential theoretical orientation, with a focus shifting from changing culture to functioning societies. For Malinowski and Brown, culture is a functionally integrated system in which each institution has a purpose and is related to other institutions. Malinowski tended to see institutions as satisfying individual needs, whereas for Radcliffe Brown, their function was to keep the social structure intact. Following these, there appeared three 20th century approaches to culture based on ideas. These are culture as cognitive system, culture as structural system, and culture as symbolic system. The cognitivists viewed culture as a system of categories constructed by the natives leading to behavior. The structuralists, among whom Lévi-Strauss was the leading figure, looked for universal principles of thought, the unconscious and underlying structural variants similar to the psychic unity of humankind of the unilinear evolutionary. According to Lévi-Strauss, human mind thinks fundamentally in terms of binary oppositions and their unification. Clifford Geertz and others viewed culture as an ordered system of symbols and meanings in terms of which social action takes place. The cultural ecologists like Julian Steward and others viewed culture as an adaptive system, as an expression of people's adaptation to their environmental setting. Thus, the development and progress of anthropological thought over the years is also seen as nothing but a continuous attempt to develop and refine the perspectives of culture, with every fresh attempt, instead of taking away the merit of the earlier perspectives of culture, only adding new dimensions to the view of culture. The immediate task here is to focus on the development of the perspectives of culture that laid the foundation to the development of modern anthropology in general and of the American anthropology in particular. As mentioned earlier, it was Franz Boas who laid the foundation to the modern anthropology by challenging the established evolutionary perspective of culture in anthropology. An alternative to the Anglo-American anthropology that advocated in the evolutionary sequential arrangement of past and present societies emerged in the German-speaking countries with its scientific roots in geography and philology, with a focus on particular societies rather than with universal human histories. This particularistic and historical approach was taken to and spearheaded in the United States at the end of the 19th century by German-trained scholar Franz Boas and his followers, who advocated the diffusionist approach in understanding change in societies and cultures as a consequence of migration and borrowing. The unilinear evolutionary hierarchies and the presumptions were challenged by the Boasians on a number of fronts. First, their fieldwork, largely among the American Indians, showed the widespread influences of diffusion between cultures. All cultures learned from each other throughout their histories. Also, the discovery that cultural adaptation to particular local physical environment had an important influence on evolution led to a more pluralistic and multilineal approach to culture change. The comparison of cultures that arose in the early 20th century anthropology produced diverse theoretical and methodological consequences, most notably the concept of cultural relativism, a theory of culture contact or acculturation, and an emphasis on the study of symbolic meaning. Perhaps the most important achievement of Boas and his students was the demonstration that there is no necessary connection between culture and race, that the capacity for culture of specific groups was not genetically controlled, and that the freedom to create cultures independent of biology was one of the great achievements of human evolution. The Boasian resistance to the sweeping and confining generalizations of classic evolutionism is said to have two consequences. One, an emphasis on culture change at a specific level of analysis. And the second is the priority on studying the patterns or configuration of local cultural beliefs and values. Pattern on and configuration became the key concepts for explaining the relation of cultural traits to each other, the study of local patterning of cultural traits and changes over time. Ruth Benedict's popular presentation, Patterns of Culture, though espousing a cultural psychology, is an example, as is the rigorous and massive configurations of culture growth by another of Boas' students, A.L. Kroeber. The development of American cultural anthropology between the two world wars and into the decades of the 1960s was also significantly shaped by the anthropological linguist Edward Sapir, who demonstrated the determinative effect of language on culture and worldview, and who argued that culture is largely psychological. Since language is central to the task of ethnographer, to learning, to the expression of thought and values, and to the transmission of culture, Sapir's language anchored perspectives have had important and continuing resonance. His psychological emphasis was influential in the culture and personality movement that flourished under other Boasians, notably Ruth Benedict and Margaret Mead. Franz Boas was born and educated in Germany. He visited the United States in 1884 and 1886. As a geographer in the course of expeditions to the Arctic and British Columbia, and began his American career in New York in 1887. He joined Columbia University in 1896 as a lecturer in physical anthropology and became professor of anthropology in 1899, his lifetime post from which he retired in 1936. He was born and educated in Germany. And he moved to Columbian University. When he moved to Columbian University, American anthropology was supposed to be operating within a 19th century theoretical legacy, which was supposed to be conspicuously racist. Boas became the most influential anthropologist of his time, considered by many as the architect of its modern structure. To Boas, can be credited a critical reconstruction of anthropology and its principal branches, as well as the emergence of the modern concept of culture. Boas had led physical anthropology from taxonomic race classification into a field of viable research in human biology by exposing and eliminating the traditional ambiguities in the area of race and culture study. His leadership in the study of American Indian languages, he became the established reference point for the development of the structural linguistics and for the relation of language, thought, and culture. His critique of the 19th century unilineal cultural evolution established by both the historicity of cultural development and the primary role of culture in history. According to Franz Boas, each society has its own unique historical development. This view, known as historical particularism, maintained that each society must be understood as a product of its own history. The same led Boas to adapt the notion of cultural relativism, the belief that each society should be understood in terms of its own cultural practices and values. One aspect of this view is that no society evolved higher or lower than another. We cannot rank any particular society above another in terms of degree of savagery, barbarity, or civility. Boas called for an end to the use of these ethnocentric terms. These Boasian views became the dominant theoretical trend in anthropology during the first half of the 20th century. By 1911, with the publication of his book, The Mind of Primitive Man, collecting some of his important studies, he had already paved the way for restructuring anthropology, defining in modern terms the scope and problems both of the gender field and of its separable branches. Boas' work thereafter, as that of most modern anthropology, had been built upon the new baselines that he himself had established. It also established the relative autonomy of cultural phenomena. Cultures in plural rather than culture in singular became fundamental to the study of man. It was a watershed book that helped pave the way for the modern understanding of the race as a cultural construct. A similar understanding characterized his later book, Race, Culture, and Race, Language, and Culture. In addition to this critical work, Boas added new dimensions to the understanding of the relation of cultures and humans. Psychological considerations, which defined cultures as the environments of human thought and behavior, and biological considerations, which established the role of cultural environment and hereditary factors in human biological life, growth, and variation. This conception of cultures gave anthropology its modern integration. All the various aspects of human life, according to Boas, the bodily form, language, culture, as well as the environment in which man is placed, are interrelated, and the form of culture is a result of this integration. Boas' historical approach involved the consideration of every cultural phenomena as a result of historical happenings. By precept and example, Boas made fieldwork among living cultures a hallmark of American anthropology. He continued for more than 40 years to focus on the culture of one people, that is, the Quakutu, seeking, on the one hand, to understand the Quakutu culture in the historical cultural context of the Northwest Coast, and on the other hand, to provide as comprehensive and rounded an archive record of culture as he was able to obtain. Although Boas referred to the history of culture as an aim of ethnology, in practice, history to him was more a dimension of data than an end of research. He was less concerned with historical reconstructions than with the techniques for dealing with the historicity of the phenomena involved in a particular problem. Boas spoke out boldly throughout his life against racism and race prejudice, against narrow nationalism and war, and for an internationalism based on the common interests of humanity. Franz Boas is recognized widely as the father of American anthropology because at Columbia University, he trained a generation of graduate students who transformed an assortment of classificatory schemes based on evolutionary hierarchies into a comprehensive four-field discipline that integrated linguistics and archaeology with biological anthropology and cultural anthropology. In addition, Boas was a pioneering public intellect who used science to challenge ideas of racial inferiority, the barbarism of certain cultures, by employing empirical research to demonstrate how racism, the environment, and the history of specific cultures can explain difference and diversity. At Columbia, Boas was a powerful professor who attracted students with his message that, in the words of anthropologist Ruth Benedict, anthropology mattered. It mattered because it demonstrated the twin principles of cultural determinism and cultural relativism. Cultural determinism taught that nurture, not nature, was responsible for the overwhelming array of ethnographically observed cultural similarities and differences. Cultural relativism, meanwhile, taught that one culture should not be judged by the standards of another culture. Together, these two principles showed that racism and ethnocentrism were wrong. Between 1901 and 1928, 20 students earned their doctoral degrees under Boas, among whom include Ruth Benedict, Alfred Kroeber, Margaret Mead, and Edward Sapir. Coming to Alfred Louis Kroeber, he was born in New Jersey in 1876. His parents were Protestants of German ancestry. He took a deep interest in English literature. His lifespan almost coincides with the rise of academic anthropology in the United States and with its emergence as a professionalized field of scholarly investigation. He received in 1902 the first PhD in anthropology awarded by Columbia University, and the second in the United States awarded for a dissertation on his fieldwork among the Arapaho. He spent most of his career at the University of California, where he worked as both a professor of anthropology and the director of what was then the University of California Museum of Anthropology. One reason for Kroeber's choice of anthropology was, as a career, was almost certainly idealistic. He felt that no other subject could do as much as anthropology to clear away the taboos and the confused thinking, and so to aid man's progress. He is sometimes referred to as the last anthropologist who could make a significant contribution to all the subfields of anthropology. This is true insofar as he was interested in the unity of anthropology as a discipline. But he considered himself, first of all, an ethnologist, and his central concern was with the nature of culture and the search for an understanding of its processes. In some ways, Kroeber was his most influential book was Anthropology, published in 1923. During the period in which anthropology first gained extensive recognition as a professional discipline, and the number of anthropologists began to grow rapidly, this particular work of Kroeber was the only textbook and was also a major resource from which scholars in other fields, as well as the general public, learned about anthropology. The 1948 second edition bears a subtitle, Race, Language, Culture, Psychology, and Prehistory. For Kroeber, these were the main subjects of anthropology. A very large part of the book deals with historical problems and the growth of civilizations. In the field of linguistics, Kroeber's contribution was substantial and long continuing. Much of his work stemmed from his research in California, but he also wrote on the relationships among Australian languages, and he suggested several Middle American language groupings. His early interests were primarily historical. His most extensive reporting on a single tribe was perhaps his early work on the Arapaho. The Nature of Culture, published in 1952, mostly consisted of reprints of his earlier papers or selections therefrom, arranged and annotated by Kroeber himself. It indicates the development of his major theoretical interests. In fact, Kroeber's most systematic theoretical treatments deal with the nature of culture and its processes. These themes dominated his more important courses, as well as several of his major monographs. Milton Singer points out that Kroeber's approach to culture was in terms of patterning rather than in terms of structure, and that culture was, for Kroeber, a global concept. For Kroeber, as for many of his contemporaries, the term culture is referable to pan-human phenomena. Hence, ultimate explanations must deal not only with the cultures of specific societies, but also with culture as a universal human characteristic. Each culture possesses unique aspects of content and pattern, which require explanation, but represent only a temporary historical current, the pan-human CF culture. Grover contended that each culture, to some degree, shares aspects of content and pattern with other cultures. And if several adjacent cultures are surveyed from a sufficient distance, regional patterning would emerge. In a different sense, Grover also saw patterning in the distribution, association, and clustering of traits which cross-cut cultures and even regions. While specific cultures are the basic units, the full understanding of culture must include and culture configuration. A major purpose of Grover's statistical studies and the culture element surveys was to provide more objective classification methods. The purpose was related to his interest in the culture area, which he saw as a classification device that could also be useful in historical reconstruction. From the beginning, Grover insisted that culture areas lack absolute boundaries and that the centers of cultural climax are as much a result of drawing in of culture elements as they are centers of origination and dispersal. His major contribution dealing with culture areas, that is, cultural and natural areas of native North America, published in 1939, Grover outlined 6 grand areas, 56 areas, and 43 sub-areas. Here he also declares the concept of a culture area is a means to an end. The end may be the understanding of cultural processes as such, or of the historic events of culture. He also claims that he was dealing in cultural wholes, meaning apparently patterns or configurations, rather than in traits or complexes, which always constitute only a fraction of the entirety of any one culture. Grover explains that cultural processes, diachronically, events cannot occur without process, or process without events, which introduces time as a factor in all events. The basis for most of Grover's reconstructions is the process of diffusion or borrowing. All cultures, almost self-evidently, are in large part composed of elements borrowed from other cultures, however much they may be reworked, adapted, and fitted into distinctive patterns. But not all things that are similar are necessarily borrowed. In his book, Anthropology, Grover characteristically opens his chapter on diffusion with a discussion of the practice Kuwait, a set of similar behavioral restrictions placed upon the father at the birth of a child. This particular practice was found in Europe among the Basques and in Brazil among some Indians. Grover argued that the Kuwait is not the result of diffusion. Instead, it may be a response to a universal human experience. Thus, independent invention, parallelism, and convergence are equally possible explanations of similarities along with diffusion. Grover felt strongly that individual cultures must be considered as wholes, although he never developed a holistic approach that satisfied him. He was sympathetic to Ruth Benedict's patterns or configurations of culture and constantly used these terms himself. By the term patterns or configurations, Grover customarily meant recurring clusters of phenomena. Sometimes the terms are used to describe the spatial distribution of concrete clusterings. More importantly, in explaining the peaks of climaxes in the history of culture, culture areas, and the differential frequency of geniuses at different times and places, his major work on the subject titled Configurations of Culture Growth attempts to identify for nations and areas of the old world, culminations or peaks in various fields of aesthetic and intellectual endeavor. These peaks are characterized by the emergence of large number of exceptional individuals. Grover suggested that the appearance of these geniuses is the result of the emergence of new patterns, their exploitation until possibilities have been exhausted, and their subsequent decline and disintegration until some productive new pattern is formed either in the same or some other area. He explained the appearance and recognition of genius and the flourishing of civilizations in cultural terms. Coming to his term, superorganic, culture is to be explained in cultural terms was Grover's long-standing objection to reductionism. This viewpoint appears many times in his work, but is most explicitly stated in his article, The Superorganic, and in so-called social science. In both these articles, Grover argues for a hierarchy of phenomena ranging from the inorganic, organic, and psychic to the superorganic or sociocultural. Viewed through Spencer's social evolutionary thought, superorganic refers to the claim that culture is an entity that exists over and beyond the individuals that make it up. That is, just as inorganic entities such as rocks and organic biological entities such as plants have real ontological existence, so does the super or metaphors of culture. Grover's main thesis is that at each level, some phenomena may be reducible or explainable in terms of the level below, but some cannot be explained. His theory of the superorganic asserts that culture develops its own unique style patterns. Within any given society, the style pattern entails certain cultural goals, ideals, and orientations that are aspired to, and once formed, are somewhat fixed and rigidly structured. The society then moves inevitably towards realizing and manifesting those ideals, developing, growing all in conformity to the style pattern. It is an incremental process over time, as each element is brought into place, each of which is a precursor and antecedent for the next element building on itself until the style pattern is fully realized, resulting in a cultural climax. Once a culture style pattern is fully realized, there is an inevitable fatigue and decline in that culture. The importance and presence of cultural diversity is imperative to the health of any given society. Grover's theory suggests that with the fatigue of any particular style pattern, a new style pattern can be much more readily established given the diversity of ideals present to build upon. How different is Grover's style pattern from Kuhn's paradigm. Examples of such paradigm shifts include the cosmos of Ptolemy replaced by Copernicus and Newton, or the cosmos of positivism and modernity replaced by postmodernism. And at a more micro level, in the discipline of anthropology, such shifts include the emergence and crisis in cultural evolution, followed by historical particularism, followed by functionalism, followed by structuralism, followed by constructionism, etc., etc. Coming to Edward Sapir, he was born in Germany in 1884 and was 5 years old. 5 years old when his family emigrated to the United States. He went on to do a year of graduate work in Germanics at Columbia, and at that time, his interest in language brought him into contact with Franz Boas. He quickly learned from Boas that the great potentialities of the anthropological study of language, and from then on, his principal work was in linguistic anthropology. Sapir's primary work was always in the study of language. Upon receiving a doctorate at Columbia, Sapir obtained his first important position as head of the Division of Anthropology at the Canadian National Museum in Ottawa in 1910. During the 15 years he spent in Canada, Sapir studied the Native American languages of Western Canada. Two important works were published during the Canadian years. The first, Time Perspective in Aboriginal American Culture, a Study in Method. It was a succinct account of the techniques available to ethnographers for the reconstruction in the absence of written sources of cultural history. The second work, Sapir's only full-length book, was An Introduction to the Scientific Linguistics, titled Language, published in 1921, in which he delineates the full range of what the study of language, both structure and history, entails. In his book, he introduces a concept of linguistic drift, a theory arguing that grammatical change in language is never random, but rather the result of certain systematic trends followed through in the course of a language or language family's history. In 1925, Sapir accepts a teaching position in the newly created Department of Anthropology at the University of Chicago. During this period, Sapir began publishing his most important papers in linguistic and cultural theory. Recognizing the unconscious reality of both the phonological and grammatical aspects of language led Sapir to argue that culture should be considered as patterns of individually learned conventions, both conscious and unconscious, rather than external facts. That is, in more current phrasing, culture is best defined as learned rules for behaving rather than the result of conventional behavior. Sapir was fascinated by problems of language and its connection with logic thought and the total culture of which it was a part. On a more theoretical level, Sapir, in collaboration with his student Benjamin Wolf, demonstrated the power of language to shape categories of thought, including, in principle, thoughts about race. Sapir's work as a researcher, teacher, and theorist has exerted a permanent influence on the study of language and has stimulated new work in sociolinguistics, ethnolinguistics, psycholinguistics, semantics, and semiotics. Another major anthropologist, Ruth Benedict, who was the originator of the configurational approach to culture, was a matured woman when she entered into anthropology. Her main training was in English literature. She came to anthropology without previous experience in science. This discipline, anthropology, attracted her as one that made it possible to place in manageable perspective the contrast between the cultures of different peoples and between different historical periods. With her background in humanities, she approached a body of cultural materials as a whole, in the sense in which the productive output of a writer or a painter forms a whole. And she conceived of a group of human beings and their culture as forming a total intellectual, religious, and aesthetic construct. In 1921, she was led through them to Franz Boas at Columbia University. In 1923, she received her doctorate on the basis of her thesis, The Concept of the Guardian Spirit in North America. From this study of the guardian spirit and the vision quest among North American Indians, she turned to comparative work on folklore. While doing fieldwork among the Pima in 1927, she was struck by the tremendous contrast between the culture of the Pueblo Indians with its behavioral emphasis on harmony, order, and restraint, and the Pima culture with its emphasis on extreme types of behavior. Now, for the first time, she felt she had found an organizing principle that would give form to the scattered observations coming out of diffusionist research and comparative studies of folklore. According to Ruth Benedict, the integration in a culture is brought about by its content being arranged into a prominent, into a permanent or semi-permanent design or style. Such a design she calls pattern. Within a culture, there would be the style of each large segment, and these segmental styles would come together into super style, which would be the design of the culture as a whole. This is called configuration. She saw individual cultures as drawing differentially on the inherent potentialities of human beings, emphasizing certain potentialities in successive generations and ignoring or even disallowing other potentialities. Using the cultural content available to them, techniques, forms of social organization, religious themes, and so on, the heritors of each culture elaborate a particular personality style at the expense of other possible styles. All styles are harmonious with each other and blend into a harmonious configuration. This harmony arises out of a main tendency or trend which every culture exhibits in all its aspects. The main tendency or trend she calls the genius of a culture. It is this genius or spirit of a people which brings about integration in their culture, the integration of form. In human society, this genius may be one of the two possible types, the Apollonian or the Dionysian. Apollonian is derived from Apollo, the sun god of the ancient Greeks. Apollo is regarded as the god of peace, discipline, kind, and humanity. Thus, in the Apollonian pattern of culture, one finds the existence of peace, kindness, and discipline. Ruth Benedict cites the example of Pueblo of New Mexico as a representative of Apollonian culture. The Apollonian genius represents the principle of calm, composure, and the same would characterize all aspects of the culture concerned and bring about its integration. The word Dionysian is derived from the name of Greek god Dionysius. Dionysius is the symbol of the luxurious life and drinking. In the Dionysian culture, it is formed with a great deal of storm. Ruth Benedict cited the example of Dobu and the Kwakutl cultures of Northwest Coast of America as the representatives of Dionysian genius. Dobu of Melanesia is exactly in contrast with the Pueblo Indians in their character and temperament. Among them frequently occurred conflict, competition, and violence. They used magic usually to harm others. People of Wakutl do not believe in religious practices. In their culture, wealth determines status and prestige. Everyone is seen in earning for money by hook and crook. The above study clearly reveals the influence of personality on culture. The cultures of these groups differ because their members have different characters and personality. Accordingly, they behave in cultural groups. Ruth Benedict used the terms personality writ large and time binding to describe characteristics of this process of selection, which she saw as occurring over many generations and as involving many individuals. This configurational formulation provided a theoretical framework for anthropologists who were interested in such problems as the relationship of constitution and temperament to culture, or different types of enculturation. With a sense of the infinite range of human potentialities, Ruth Benedict emphasized the great variety of cultural configurations that have been and still may be found. Moreover, she insisted that each item of culture must be judged relative to the culture in which it occurs. This work of the last years of her life, the work that she brought out in the last years of her life, was the outgrowth of her work during the World War II, when she conducted a series of studies of culture at a distance, using anthropological techniques of work with cultural holes and living informants in combination with the analysis of cultural products, films, plays, novels, works of history, and so on, to produce cultural descriptions relevant to the prosecution of the war and later the formulation of conditions of peace. Ruth Benedict selected Japanese prisoners kept in American concentration camp for studying national character of Japan. She interviewed Japanese prisoners in America, went through their diaries, took life histories and case study. She also interviewed Japanese immigrants in USA. In 1945, when the war was over, she wrote the book titled The Chrysanthemum and the Sword, as a contribution to an understanding of the cultural potentialities of Japan as part of a peaceful and cooperative world. Chrysanthemum is a national flower of Japan. It symbolizes socialization process of Japanese children. In the childhood, Japanese parents take every care for their children and they blossomed like chrysanthemum flower. In adolescence, they have to face the situations of utter strain. As a result, they become aggressive and violent. A sword always hangs on their neck. The personality of childhood in Japanese culture is, according to Margaret Mead, according to Ruth Benedict, like Apollonian genius, but the personality of adulthood is like Dionysian genius. Ruth Benedict begins patterns by pointing out that because the possibilities for a viable way of life are almost limitless, selection becomes a prime necessity of human history. A group of people creates, borrows, and selects materials that it integrates into a consistent pattern called cultural totality. in Benedict's approach, the meaning of any item that has been incorporated into the whole depends upon its place within their whole. Over time, disparate cultural traits are woven together in a fundamental pattern such that any one of them can be understood only in terms of its relationship to all others. Moreover, because cultural wholes are patterns of values in terms of which humans understand the world, people tend to understand or misunderstand other cultures by interpreting them in terms of their own. This particular tension is exemplified in Chrysanthemum, a book that came out of Benedict's work analyzing cultures for the United States government during the World War II. As her study of Japan illustrates, Benedict believed that anthropology, by helping people to see their culture in a new light, could lead them to change customs that were no longer useful to or humane. But such reforms were not to be imposed by force. Rather, they should emerge, Benedict thought, from democratic discussion, both nationally and internationally. The spirit of cultural appreciation and the humane understanding that pervades this book made it the most acceptable of all the wartime contributions by anthropologists to the field that later came to be known as the national character research. Although the accuracy of many small details has been criticized, the book has had an enormous influence both within Japan and among those who worked with the Japanese after the war. Her book needs to be examined in the context of the time and not dissected decades later. Coming to Margaret Mead, in a lifetime of 77 years, she wrote close to 30 books, edited a dozen more, contributed hundreds of articles, helped lead major professional associations, and was one of the most sought-after lecturers in the nation. She attended Columbia University, from which she received her MA in psychology. At Columbia, two anthropologists changed the course of her life. First was Franz Boas, who already possessed an international reputation and whose paternalism led students to call him Papa Franz. The second influence was Ruth Benedict, who was Boas' earliest disciple, as well as his doctoral student and teaching assistant. Mead majored in psychology but found the course of her life changed in her senior years when she took a course in anthropology from the famous Franz Boas. Boas urged Mead to conduct her doctoral dissertation in American Samoa, where she might find that adolescence unfolded differently than it did in the United States. In seeking to prove Boas' contention that adolescent behavior was more cultural than biological, she asked, "Are the disturbances which vex our adolescents due to the nature of adolescence itself or to civilization? Under different circumstances, does adolescence present a different picture?" After completing her studies in 1925, she set off on her own for fieldwork in Samoa. She hoped to determine whether the experience of adolescence as a time of intense emotion and conflict was universal or limited to Western cultures. Inexperienced but energetic and having learned to speak Samoa, Mead moved in with a Samoan household and stayed for 9 months, becoming part of a community of 50 teenage girls and closely observing their habits and behaviors. Mead was practicing a new technique in which a so-called participant observer takes part in the lives of his or her subjects. She strongly believed that this was the best way to generate good data about them. It was during her 20s that Mead produced her most famous work, Coming of Age in Samoa. She found that Samoans experienced adolescence as a much less stressful transition to adulthood than did teenagers in the United States or Europe. For Mead, there are biological differences between males and females, but how these differences make a difference is greatly dependent on the cultural environment in which they are staged, interpreted, and made consequential. Mead found that in contrast to the conflict on stressful adolescence common in United States and European society, Samoan teenagers were calm, happy, and completely at ease with their blossoming sexuality. She also determined that neither monogamy nor jealousy was valued in Samoan culture. Mead concluded that the experience of adolescence is determined not by biology, but by cultural conditioning. Her conclusions pointed to a new way of looking at the so-called primitive cultures, which had previously been seen as childlike or backward. Perhaps these people, Mead suggested, actually had a better way of approaching the transition to adulthood. Coming of Age in Samoa became a classic for its news that adolescence is more a cultural preoccupation than a biological imperative. Controversial due both to its sexual subject matter and its conclusions, Coming of Age in Samoa was a bestseller in an era when some found the major advances occurring in science and technology and sociology troubling. In subsequent fieldwork, Mead studied younger children in New Guinea and toddlers in Bali. In each case, she delivered a cultural analysis of the child-rearing processes by documenting those consequences in child-other behavior which carry the greatest communication weight and so are crucial for the development of each culturally regular character structure. This research was published in 1930 as Growing Up in New Guinea. Mead had returned to New Guinea in 1931 for further work on the differences between biological and cultural influences. Sex and Temperament in Three Primitive Societies, a psychocultural study in which Mead deals with the impact of culture on personality, was the outcome of the fieldwork in three villages in New Guinea. Mead published her own book entitled Keep Your Powder Dry. This book deals with methodology of studying national character without making direct observation, hence the name Culture Study at a Distance. She did not see differences in the personalities of child in America and to that of any other countries like Japan and Russia. Their early personality was similar. They gradually start to differ as the family education and school education differ. In this way, culture and personality develop in them, reflect their national characters. Another book from the this period is New Lives for Old, which chronicles Mead's visit to the New Guinea village she had studied 25 years earlier. She documented the difficulties being experienced by the adults who had grown from the children she interviewed during her first visit as the modern world intruded on their culture. While Coming of Age in Samoa established Mead's reputation as an anthropologist who studied sexuality, especially the sexual behavior of adolescent girls, subsequent books focused on education in the so-called primitive cultures, gender roles and male-female relations, acculturation, the relationship between culture and the development of adult personality, national character, etc. Following her death, some critics suggested that her work in Samoa was not as thorough as it should have been. The most prominent among these was the American-Australian anthropologist Derek Freeman, a Mead admirer and fellow anthropologist who spent 6 years in Samoa and learned to speak Samoan fluently. In 1983, 5 years after Mead's death, Freeman published a critical account of Mead's Samoan research. In his book, Margaret Mead and Samoa, The Making and Unmaking of an Anthropologist, Anthropological Myth, in which he claims that Mead's research was shallow and imprecise, and that the Samoans themselves felt she had been incorrect in her conclusions. He had claimed that Mead's informants had duped her and that her conclusions about the relative freedom towards premarital sex she had claimed characterized Samoan society were false. He argued that Mead was overly zealous in trying to prove Boas' claim for the power of culture over biology. Although Mead was not able to respond to Freeman's critic herself, many anthropologists who had worked in Samoa or who were proponents of the importance of cultural factors in shaping human behavior came to her defense. They did so despite their acknowledgement of some factual errors in her Samoan research, which they claimed were of minor significance and the result of her youth and the infancy of anthropology as a social science. In November 1983, the American Anthropological Association censored Freeman, citing inconsistencies and errors in his critique of Mead's Samoan research. Thus, the central tendencies and recurrent debates since the mid-19th century have engaged universalist versus particularist perspectives, scientific versus humanist perspectives, and the explanatory power of biology versus that of culture. Two persistent themes have been the dynamics of culture change and the symbolic meanings at the core of culture. The humanistic roots of cultural anthropology produced some of the major tendencies of the later half of the 20th century. Cultural anthropology in America has long studied the folklore, music, art, folk, worldview, and indigenous philosophies and other cultures. Humanistic scholarship typically makes qualitative or interpretative statements about complex patterning or configurations of experience and local meaning, which cannot easily be done by formal scientific procedures. The pluralistic and relativistic conception of culture, a product of the Bauhaus revolution in anthropology, has characterized anthropological thought for almost 50 years, at least until the early 1950s, when a revival of interest in universalistic theories occurred. Leslie White talks of two streams in the theories of culture which have dominated anthropological thinking from about 1900 to 1950, attributing largely to the American and British tradition of anthropology. These are the process pattern theory derived from Boas and best represented by Crowell and others, and the structural functional theory derived from Malinowski and Ratliff. While the process pattern theory takes the concept of culture pattern as basic, and the structural theory takes social structure as basic, both theories cover the full range of Tyler's cultural concept. Each theory, according to him, is holistic and universal. Each seeks to explain all aspects of culture within a single theoretical framework, and each intends to apply that framework to societies and cultures of any kind, from small primitive societies to complex civilizations. The difference between the two basic theories, in his view, cannot be derived from the complementary character of the two basic concepts. The difference between the two theories is to be found in different ways they connect culture and social structure within explanatory systems. In an article, Concept of Culture, Leslie White says that virtually all cultural anthropologists take it for granted, no doubt, that culture is the basic and central concept of their science. He further says much of the discussion of the concept of culture in recent years has been concerned with the distinction between culture and human behavior. But eventually some began to object to this and to make the point that culture is not itself behavior, but is an abstraction from behavior. The reasoning is simple. The danger was real and imminent, the situation critical. What was to be done? He raises the question, if culture as an abstraction is intangible, imperceptible, does it exist? Is it real? When culture becomes an abstraction, it not only becomes invisible and imponderable, it virtually ceases to exist. Finally, according to Leslie White, our distinction and definition is in very close accord with anthropological tradition. This is what Tyler meant by culture, as a reading of primitive culture will make clear. And he uses the term, when culture becomes an abstraction, it not only becomes invisible and imponderable. Alternatively, White suggests that culture is a class of things and events dependent upon symboling, considered in an extra-somatic context, which meets the requirements of a scientific definition. To conclude, with the views of Leon Goldstein, it is not uncommon to find definitions that appear to answer the question, what is culture? Here, we are no longer interested in the definition of a word or in the specification of the subject matter of a field of inquiry, but rather in the discovery of what is essential to the nature of something. Essentialistic definitions of culture have, in no small measure, given rise to the view that a major goal of anthropology is the construction of a theory of culture as something different from, and perhaps more important than, the formulation of theories dealing with specific cultural phenomena such as magic, kinship, or language. Hence, he says, concern with the nature of reality is the business of metaphysics rather than physics. In the same way, the theory of culture is a branch of speculative philosophy, while the job of theoretical anthropology is to offer the best explanation of cultural phenomena. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for a great lecture, and it was a great journey to go through with this concept and the theory. I would open the floor for the question and answers if somebody have any question or any kind of discussion.
Hello, hi.
Hello.
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 Thank you so much for an illuminating talk, Professor. My name is Darshini, and I'm actually video conferencing from the UK right now. So it's really a huge privilege to listen to your talk. And as you say, it's always useful to revisit the classics and situate it within our current context. And I think the critique on Margaret Mead's work that you mentioned brings to light a more pressing issue, which is ownership and imperialism. Decolonial researchers are attempting to carve out a space for subaltern and marginalized groups to speak back. Scholars such as Raywin Connell, Boaventura de Sousa Santos, and Linda Tuhiwai Smith have been very quick to describe a dependency to these colonial narratives as epistemicide, or a colonization of knowledges, where Anglo and Western researchers determine what is culture and how it ought to be studied. And as you so eloquently put it, Professor, culture then ceases to exist. It becomes invisible and ceases to exist. So my question to you is, how can we reimagine anthropology that is more contextualized to our own culture, where we will be able to claim its ownership without having to resort to Western scholars coming in and telling us how culture ought to be studied and how it ought to be conceptualized? Thank you.
You have rightly put. Culture needs to be contextualized. As we know, today there are very many voices coming up, which is a development of understanding of culture in the new phase. We have the subaltern voices, the women voices, etc. But all these have to be understood, as rightly developed in the American anthropology, that concept cultural relativism. We need to listen to the local voices in its context and understand. I think if you have to look back to the works of anthropologists at that time, point of time, we need to consider in the context which they studied, and they, in fact, they, it was a revolution at that point of time.
Keep the mic closer to your mouth, Professor Gregory. We are not able to hear you properly. Sorry.
Okay. Now, so what I was telling, we need to contextualize our understanding of culture, and we need to recognize the new voices that are coming up in the form of subaltern voices, the gender voices, and different communities, and try to understand from their point of view, as rightly put by the anthropologists in the American tradition, developed the concept of cultural relativism, which very boldly fought against the racist ideology. And understanding the works of then anthropologists, we need to again contextualize the time and the period in which they were bringing up these works. Hello.
Yes, Professor. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you so much for that.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Shani. Anybody else have any question or any discussion to share? Okay. So I guess there are no more. Oh, there is one question, I guess.
Hello, Ananditya.
Yes.
This is Shakil from Pakistan.
Shakil Ahmed, yeah.
Sir, thank you so much for the wonderful thought-provoking session. I just have a small minute question, and that is pertaining to the well-said quotation that culture is our second nature.
Pardon?
Hello? My question
could you please repeat?
Yes. Hello? I read somewhere that culture is our second nature.
Okay.
Amid COVID-19, do you think cultural boundaries are revitalizing? People are becoming more conscious when it comes to countries, communities, and societies? Cultural conscious?
In fact, in the context of COVID, culture, as we know, culture is dynamic. It is continuously redefined and understood in new contexts. And in the context of COVID, the new behavioral tendencies that we tend to adapt are the responses to the external environment in which we are living. And these new tendencies, I don't know how it is going to be shaped in the coming days, but I am sure definitely it will have an effect on the cultural understandings and of the communities. And on the one hand, we are becoming inwardness, that we tend to assert our individual identities and community identities of the communities. And at the same time, we need to also realize that we are living in a society where, as COVID has very clearly brought out, that we cannot but understand the interrelatedness of our relation, interrelatedness of the nature of community, that we need to take the entire humanity into consideration and respond to and reach out to other communities. So on the one hand, we need to take care of our own individual selves and individual identities. And at the same time, we need to also reach out to other communities in order to find out a long-lasting solution for the problems that are challenges that we face in the context of COVID.
Thank you so much for enlightening.
Thank you very much.
Wonderful answer. Thank you. Stay blessed.
So there is a question from Lewis. He's wanting to your response to the project of Roy Wagner in relation to the concept of culture on his book The Invention of Culture, which breaks with the paradigms of North American cultural anthropology.
Could you repeat the question? I'm not able to get. Hello?
Yeah. So he wants to know your response to the Roy Wagner work on the concept of culture. The book name is The Invention of Culture, which is written in 1975. And it deals with the paradigms of North American cultural anthropology. What is your remark on it?
But I am not very familiar with this particular book. Inventions of culture, published in 1975, right? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I am not familiar with this particular writing. What exactly he says in this book? Would you?
He has quoted that the invention of culture is an inspiration for surprising works to problematize the use of the concept of culture. An example is the article by Merlin Slattern, No Nature, No Culture, The Hagen Case, in 1980.
I'll look into it. I am not much familiar with this particular work.
If Lewis, you can please throw some light on it. Please make yourself.
Probably, Lewis can throw light on that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Is he online?
Lewis, are you there? Can
Hello?
You please unmute yourself and speak to Professor?
Hello,
Louis, you can speak. I have unmuted you. I guess
I think there is some
I guess he doesn't want to. So any more questions?
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, this is Naresh Vaid from Delhi. I'm a practicing anthropologist. You said that we are concerned with theorizing culture, but I do not understand how you limit the dimensions of culture. I'll have to explain that. We talk about human cultures only, but what about the subhuman cultures? And secondly, molecular biologists, they consider chimp and gorilla also in the genus Homo, that is in our own genus. Then how to define culture? That can be without any debate.
Hello, I think I have a low net. Hello.
I can hear you.
The network is a problem. Okay, and could you please repeat? Subhuman
I said
culture.
You said we are concerned with theorizing culture, but unless we decide theorizing the dimensions culture, of culture, how can we theorize? On the one hand, I don't know whether we include subhuman primates activities in culture or not. And secondly, molecular biologists, they include chimp and gorilla also in the genus Homo. Homo means our own genus. Then how to decide the dimensions of culture? Thank you.
Well, in our context, we are specifically talking about the human culture. But then human culture is a response to non-human environment. And definitely it has to be extended. I mean, how we respond to the non-human environment. In fact, as COVID would say that culture is man-made part of environment. So culture is a response to what is going on around us. So you cannot ignore what is going on around us. So in a way, it is an extension. Right? Yes, Naresh.
Any more questions? Okay, so I would like to thank you, sir, for this lecture. And I will invite Valuvan, sir, for the second session, for introducing the
Thank you, Anindita.
Thank you, Anindita. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Grigori. And I must thank all the participants, international participants. And I have to invite our Professor Vinay Kumar sir and Chellabrumal and all participants and international participants also on behalf of Aspire. So thank you, Professor Grigori sir. So thank you. Now I am now.